All right, good afternoon. I'm going to talk about hurricane-ocean interactions from the modeling perspectives. Our research group at URI has been involved in the development of three operational coupled models, GFDL, then HWARF, and more recently, GFDN, the Navy versions of the GFDL model. This is the current members of our research group. And what I'd like to start with is just to give you some chronology of the operational model development. In 2001, the GFDL model was coupled with the Princeton Ocean model, was a 3D coupling in the Atlantic and one-dimensional coupling in the Eastern Pacific. In 2007, the HWARF became operational and coupled with the Princeton Ocean model, with a 3D coupling in the Atlantic. In 2008, we implemented ocean coupling into the GFDN with a 3D coupling in Atlantic and 1D coupling in all our other oceans. And in 2009, the GFDN coupled system has been upgraded to three-dimensional coupling in the Pacific. Well, this diagram is about 10 years old. It was put together by National Geographic right after the GFDL model became operational. So they did a story about the first coupled hurricane ocean model. And it illustrates nicely what has been already discussed today about the importance of the depth of this warm water. And you see on left-hand side, the depth of the warm water is quite low, which is typical for the Gulf of Mexico. And you see the colder wake behind. And with a deeper depth of the warm water, there's a weaker cold wake behind. And if we look at the climatology, and this is a September climatology in the Atlantic, in the sea surface temperature, the Caribbean Sea and the Gulf of Mexico are very similar. However, if you look at the depth of the 26 degrees C, you can certainly see immediately that the depth of the warm layer is much deeper in the Caribbean Sea. And in general, it's quite more shallow in the Gulf of Mexico, and which is very fortunate for the Gulf of Mexico because that serves like a natural barrier shielding against very strong storms. But occasionally, we do have Category 5 storms in the Gulf of Mexico. And of course, everybody remembers Hurricane Katrina. This is an animation of the coupled GFDL model simulation of Hurricane Katrina crossing the Gulf of Mexico. And so you can see that the cold wake is being developed mostly on the right-hand side of the storm. But notice this break in the cooling in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico. And this break is associated with the loop currents and warm core eddy, Nick Shea just discussed all these features in the Gulf of Mexico. But the 2005 season, both Hurricane Rita and Katrina, really emphasized the importance of those features in the Gulf of Mexico and for hurricane intensity prediction. Because both the Katrina and Rita intensified to Category 5 just over the loop current. Now, at that time, in the GFDL coupled system, we did not have a good initialization of the loop current and warm core ring. So the picture, what is shown here, this is September 15, 2005, is based on the improved initialization of the Princeton Ocean model. But that was important for us now to realize that we need to improve the initialization system. So the improvements that we implemented in the operational system is based on so-called a feature modeling approach, in which we start with a climatology. This is a GDAM climatology with kind of an average position of the loop current. And then we use real-time satellite altimetry to identify the depth of the 26 degree other term. And based on that, we create these features that correspond to the loop current and warm core ring, similar to what is observed. And then the ocean is spun up, and we also simulate the sea surface temperature. So that was introduced in 2006, operational GFDL model, and here's the examples of the improvements of the temperature profiles in the loop current and to the left. So this dashed line or weak solid line is a climatology, and the solid line bold is the AXBT, and dashed line is in the model. And also you see in the warm core ring to the right also considerable improvements of the initial temperature profiles compared to climatology. And this is a simulation of the cold wake in Hurricane Katrina after assimilating the loop current. And you can see the track in black, and the cooling over the loop current was significantly less. So the significant actual cooling started to occur after Katrina left the loop current. And that probably contributed to significant weakening of Katrina prior to landfall. So to illustrate this, and actually the importance of the loop current, just going back to the slide, during Katrina, loop current northern position was about 27.6 degrees. And but typical climatological position of loop current is about 24 degrees. So the loop current actually moves south and north with a cycle about from 6 to 11 months. So the question is, what would have happened to Hurricane Katrina if the loop current was at its climatological position? So this is an illustration of the sensitivity to the loop current position. This is a simulation of with the GFDL coupled system initiated August 26, 18Z, 2005. Central pressure here, maximum wind, and the track. And red is the forecast with the loop current position in the observed location. And green is when we shifted loop current to the north. And certainly you can see immediately that the loop current did contribute to significant intensification of the Hurricane Katrina, probably as much as one category. Now, it's interesting, if we completely disable the ocean coupling in the GFDL model and redo the simulation for Hurricane Katrina, it is shown in green, we ended up having a storm reaching 870 millibars. And also you can see it continues to intensify up to landfall. So there's no weakening prior to landfall in this simulation. Switching for a moment to the Western Pacific, as I mentioned, we implemented ocean coupling in the GFDN model, and which became operational last year at the Fleet Numerical Center. And here's a simulation of Typhoon Nari 2007. Initial conditions to the left, and 96-hour forecast to the right. And in Western Pacific, of course, we are concerned about simulating the position of the Kuroshio. And you can see the interaction between the typhoon-induced currents and Kuroshio on the right-hand side. I would also make a few comments about the differences between the one-dimensional and three-dimensional coupling from the modeling perspectives. This is a simple diagram that Rich Yablonsky put together that illustrated three layers. Top is the atmosphere near surface. The middle is the sea surface layer. And the lower panel is the layer in the thermocline below. So if we impose, if the wind stress is imposed at the sea surface, it will generate the ocean currents with a very strong shear, vertical shear. This vertical shear will generate turbulent mixing and entrainment of the cold water into the upper mixed layer and will cool the ocean surface. This is one-dimensional process. But now, if we consider the cyclonic circulation associated with the tropical cyclone, then it will generate the currents, but also the currents will be divergent due to the Coriolis force. So the currents move away from the storm, and that will generate the upwelling and also the cooling. This is a three-dimensional process. Now, the upwelling is a slower in a time range process compared to one-dimensional mixing. Kidding. So if we look from the perspectives of the ocean cooling near the storm center, and this is our idealized simulations with a one-dimensional coupling in red, and in blue with a three-dimensional model, and only the function of the forward speed. And you can see at 5 meters per second, the one-dimensional and three-dimensional models provide similar cooling. But a storm moves slower, then you see the divergence. At 2.5 meters per second, the difference is about 1 degree. And this is illustrated in the cross sections, 1D on the right-hand side and three-dimensional on the left-hand side. And you can see in the one-dimensional model, it's just only mixing and deepening of the mixed layer. One on the left-hand side, the upwelling contributes to the cooling. I'm going to skip the slides. This is actual simulations in 1D 3D coupling in the Western Pacific. We found that in the three-dimensional coupling, in particular slow-moving storms, and the forecast skill is greatly improved. This is one case. And you can see that the observed storm, which is in black, was weakening at that time, and the three-dimensional coupling really picked up this weakening. However, with one-dimensional coupling, the storm continued to be on the same level. Another important contribution of three-dimensional coupling is associated with the pre-existing circulation. Now, warm core rings, and this is an example of a cross-section of a warm core ring in the Gulf of Mexico, is typically associated with a high ocean heat content, which is considered to be a positive impact on the hurricane intensity. However, if we consider the circulation, anticyclonic circulation associated with a warm core ring, the question is whether this will make a contribution to the ocean cooling. And this is a set of idealized experiments with the position of the warm core ring in the center, to the left of the storm, and to the right of the storm. And now if you look at the cooling in all these experiments, near the storm center, on the upper panel is the control case, no warm core ring in front. You see the cold wave behind. Left upper panel with a cold core ring on the warm core ring right in the center. You can see a significant reduction of the cooling. Just look at this small circle. When the warm core ring to the left, you can see some reduction of the cooling as well. But look what happens with the warm core ring on the right. In fact, the cooling is larger than even in the control case. The reason is because of the anticyclonic circulation associated with the warm core ring, then this cold water from behind is being pushed toward the center. So in three-dimensional model, the warm core ring to the right is actually worse in terms of the hurricane intensity because it may lead to larger cooling. And this is shown here, and this differences in the temperature between the warm core ring experiment on the right and the control experiment. And of course, 1D model on the right-hand side cannot simulate these differences. And finally, just a few words about the coupling. Shui Chen covered this topic. And I just want to emphasize one important point is the impact of the wind-wave-current interaction. In particular, how the currents can impact and the waves can impact the momentum flux into the ocean. And this is three papers that have been, two papers published in the Journal of Physical Oceanography last year, and one is in review, discussing the details of the wind-wave current interaction. One point to take home, what we found is with the wave coupling, the momentum flux into the ocean on the right-hand side can be reduced by about 20% compared to the wind stress. So there's a great deal of discontinuity between momentum fluxes in the atmosphere and what goes into the ocean. And this is due to interaction between waves and the ocean currents. And this is a coupled system that we are developing. It's presently implemented at the GFDL model. This later this year, it will be implemented in the H-WARF. And I will stop there. Thank you.
Thank you.